Yikes. We're back. Oh, yeah. No, we're just here. Good morning, everybody. It is Wednesday, middle of the week. We're almost through with this week. It's just wonderful here. It is so beautiful here on the Cindy Cochran Show. Uh-oh. Richard's looking over my shoulder. What happened to... This isn't my normal mic, is it? No. Okay. That's my... No, this is my normal voice. Okay. No, that's... Well, why is it... Oh, I know. I'm sitting... Usually my chair is further down. We're having some technical difficulties, and they do not lie with your ears. It's just me. You are listening to Cindy Cochran Show. Yes, you are. A Fitbit for your ear. You just have to listen fast. A lot of words are going to come at you at one time. So let's see how you do this morning after you take measure of, wow, what did I just hear? Listen, I have got, if you've read my Facebook, I've got a great guest with me today. Because this is a guest that's kind of like me in the sense that you never know what I'm going to say sometimes. But this guy is really a whole nother level.
Yalidocious.
Oh, yeah. Bring that mic up and be ready to, at any moment to kill that mic.
Off.
Yeah, so we need that 7-second delay. We don't have it.
It's cough just... button and a cuss button.
Yeah, that's what we need is a cuss button, though. We have Dennis O'Connor with us. Good morning, Dennis.
Hello.
I'm so happy that you're here today.
Oh, I'm overjoyed myself. Wait a minute. I'm not doing that bit anymore.
No.
That one's over.
I want the real Dennis. But Dennis, of course, you recognize his voice because every time we go to break, he is the one who is stating that this is the Cindy Cochran Show and you
ain't
heard nothing yet.
The most opinionated show on radio.
You know what?
Blah, blah, blah.
What
I don't,
he
I don't
a,
like that voice. What, I
it's
I don't
a
know
great
why
voice. It's a great voice. Dennis is a great actor, and so he uses his voice in a whole lot of different ways, and he knows a lot of accents and that kind of stuff. But I just love that voice. I thought it was different, and I liked, especially like this one that we haven't used a lot, where you say, "If these walls could talk, they couldn't get a word in edgewise."
Oh,
and
yeah,
so
yeah.
That.
No, I think you hear it all the time, but you just don't mentally acknowledge it because I play it every day.
Yeah, well, she doesn't listen. Not
on this show. I haven't heard you play it on this show in a long time.
You only have like 5 liners, Cindy. So, I mean, the chances of it running are pretty high.
We can make
that
up some new
true.
Ones.
That is true. We can do some new ones. No, he does want me to do some new ones and some shout-outs and some, if you're hearing the sound of my voice, that means I'm not here. And so I'm playing a pre-recorded program.
Well, what I came up with was, since she doesn't promote herself,
right,
you have to use these fake audio clips to promote her. So
yeah, because yes. I don't promote myself.
You do not promote.
See, you know, everybody thinks
except at Kroger.
She's yeah, that
but
is
they
true.
Don't know you have a radio show. They just know you as the aisle dweller.
But I am.
Aisle
and well, no, one day they will. I even told the manager. I said, one day you're going to name an aisle after me. Yeah. You will, and that's going to be very, very cool.
Well, I see somebody's Facebook the other day said, "I'm going to." I made a mistake. I went to the grocery store hungry. And I now own aisle 8.
Boy, that is true about going hungry. You should not go hungry.
I love to. Because no. I just binge stuff in.
Oh, man. You go so much more than you need to buy. but who goes and eats a huge meal just because they're going to go shopping, grocery shopping? No. Dennis.
Yes.
Listen, I know that we may be, and it may be a surprise later on, that we have someone from My Fair Lady.
It could happen.
But how are they doing? How's My Fair Lady
I haven't
going?
Been that close in touch. I've been down. I was just there a couple little times helping Deanie out, doing some helping with the in the prop, you know, with the props and stuff. But I haven't. I've been to a rehearsal or two, and it's wonderful. Oh,
well,
my goodness, it's wonderful.
See,
you can imagine.
The reason that Dennis O'Connor knows all the behind the scenes at the Crichton Theater is because he built most of the scenery there at the theater, and for a long
time.
About
4 years.
Yeah.
If there's ever going to be one true ghost of the Crichton Theater, it's going to be when Dennis sadly passes away. I'm convinced of it.
That things will fall down.
That'll be fun.
The rain won't work anymore. No, Dennis built the set for Singing in the Rain, and they were actually singing in
All right. rain.
That was just, and it was amazing.
Actually rained on stage.
Yeah. And so that'll go down in the books for that.
Yeah.
No one else will have done that. Now in the, what are those?
They got it snowing.
What are those,
now.
Oh, that's right. That's it's amazing what they can do. They but did. you were very innovative. What are those awards called? That
the what, a little
once
what?
A year, the award.
The Monties.
The Monties.
Yes.
I can't think of Monties.
Yeah.
The full Monties. they give out awards. Do they give awards for set direction or?
I've got a Monty that is for
you do
for Singing in the Rain. Yes.
You got one
yes.
for that?
Yes.
Well, you very well should have been at least nominated for that. So you won one. That's
I don't think
also.
They have that category anymore. Those set. I don't know what they call it. At that time, they were calling
set
it
design?
Set design, and that was, but it was a combination of me and Denise.
Yeah, Denise
actually designed it with me. I didn't design all that stuff, but they couldn't figure out what to get. Denise had already won two Monties that night, so.
Well, for crying out loud, we got to share that stuff. I want to know when they're going to put in. The category for best radio show. That's what I'm looking for.
I really don't know.
And then
I'm voting for it.
And then Richard will win it. Watch.
Yeah.
His morning show will win it.
Sure.
And then
it will.
We won't even be.
Well, I haven't really been on this week. So unfortunately.
Oh, you haven't been talking? You just played the
just
songs?
Off and on. It's just we had yesterday's meltdown and then this morning's meltdown with this computer. So it's just that time of the year where technology doesn't want to work.
Poor Richard.
Yeah.
And he's having to work so many things at one time, and he has to put the cameras, it changes the camera on the camera shot. And where's your shot? Do you have one today?
Yeah, I have all three of us.
He makes it look easy.
Oh, look. You can't see it, but there's a wide shot from that camera.
And what's really funny, Dennis, is when they first started this, I said, we're not a television show, so don't worry about the cameras.
Don't worry about where the camera is.
Yeah, and every day she checks on the air.
Hi, Mom.
So,
Mom?
No.
Where's the camera
and
on?
See,
yes, it's not a TV show.
No, don't even worry about
just
that.
Just the Howard Stern show.
Oh, brother, that's all I would...
We should change Cindy Cochran Show's style to that. I think that'd be a good idea.
Yeah, that's perfect. Perfect for me.
Yeah.
Listen, I do want to say that tomorrow we have Donna Wick is going to be coming on. And Donna does, she's a PR person. That she books a lot of people, a lot of different television shows, and then she makes sure that they're in front of the people they need to be, and she writes all the, you know.
What I want you to ask her tomorrow is, what is it like driving down a major highway and seeing your face on a billboard?
Yeah, she had a huge billboard.
But Diz, you ever been on a billboard before?
I have never been on a billboard.
That's on my bucket list. We're going to have the Cindy Cochran Show up on a billboard. I just know it. Someone just walked in. What's that? Oh, I think it was wrong. They didn't mean to. They're trying to get into Conroe Coffee.
I see.
Is the female coming or is the
I do not know. Yes, it was the Sarah said she's going to try to be here.
Okay.
So she's and I don't know what that means. I mean, she's a great, big star. You know, and
well,
she's a good friend.
Yeah.
And
for you, Dennis, anything. I'll be there. I'll wake up early. I'll be there. but maybe.
Well,
you know,
see, I'm retired, so, you know, I don't do anything anymore.
That's
I watch movies.
And listen to the Cindy Cochran show.
Listen to the Cindy Cochran show when I can. And I then sometimes you... fall asleep right after you say, good morning. and I...
That's all I needed. Thanks,
right
Cindy.
On.
Right to sleep.
And then all of a sudden I open my eyes and it's noon and it's like, oh, okay.
Wow.
Time for hanging with the haters.
Yeah, time for hanging with the haters if it's Wednesday.
Yeah, you wake up for Mark Hater. Yeah, they're going to be on today at 12
o'clock.
Yeah,
they put me to sleep too sometimes.
Oh, okay.
Everything puts me to sleep.
Oh. So I shouldn't take it personally, right?
Oh, no.
Oh, okay.
Oh, no, not at all. I fall asleep during great movies.
Wonderful. I'm so happy to hear that. but anyway, so Donna will be on tomorrow, and we were talking about these whiny women that feel like they're not being enough attention paid to and all that. A lot of women that of our age group went through the 60s, went through the 50s, went through the 60s and the 70s and all that, and it really made more sense to, instead of marching for things that you want, go ahead and go get them. Just go get them. And so we're just talking about the difference between some women who decide that feels like if they do it through a political way or take the process of protesting something that's wrong and all that, that that's the only way to do it. But
Donna, it's a way. It's just a way.
It's a way. And so, but Donna is talking about how she got started and where she is. But, you know, the other thing.
What's that got to do with PR stuff?
No, no, no. We're going to talk because she's a successful woman. She has.
Oh, I got.
She has
got
done a lot of
yes.
things.
Okay.
These,
okay.
And you know, if you want to have equal pay, then you start the company, and you decide who's going to get what. I think that's the way to do it. So if
well,
you
good.
Have the company, then you you can give yourself whatever you want to give yourself. But it was.
Are you just blackmail?
Yeah, or don't pay him at all.
Right.
Blackmail.
That's what you did, Cindy, right? Back in the 80s? That's what, isn't that how you got signing with Cindy?
Shut up. No, I did not. I did not. I did signing with Cindy.
You slept with a producer.
You used the men's weakness?
What? No, I did not do that. I did do the thing where you go in and you try and make the guy that's going to be the decision maker on whether you use certain equipment stuff, just tell them how great they
yes,
are.
Yes, I don't understand
and
that.
And schmooze
the whole,
them.
Well, you mentioned women. It's all equal now. There's no inequality at all now. It's absolutely gone. In every phase of society and culture, there is no such thing as inequality for women.
Then what was that big march about? What
I
was that all
not
about?
Know.
I think it was a collection
so
of everything.
Upset.
They're trying to get
that
away from
anything kids. That had to do with women.
I was so upset.
What?
I think it was just a collection. Like if you had anything, even if I had gripe with women, I could go march and just go, "Isn't this about women?" Like we're just kind of doing all our own thing.
Yeah. The men that had complaints against the women were in. Yeah,
oh, no,
like,
really?
What are you doing? Here?
You talk to anybody, they all have their own reason why they went. So I think that was just kind of they were bored.
I didn't go out. I didn't join this one.
You
this
didn't.
Time. Well,
but,
no, because considering that Trump was elected, you know, and I was very close to Kent State back in the good old days. You
oh,
know, when
man.
They started killing protesters. You know, and when I thought Trump's in house, control of the whole military, is he?
Yeah.
Nah, I'm not going outside.
Yes, you see, if you knew Dennis and Dennis's age, he does have that hippie back in the 60s, and you would have been right there in the college administration that had taken over, you know, for the colleges.
Guilty
in the 60s.
As charged.
See?
I've been on the other side of nightsticks.
Yeah, see?
Protests.
Right. That's.
I was just kidding about the inequality, too, being gone.
Right. I know, but.
Okay, I got to ask Dennis this. So we're talking about her. And
16.
Her,
the answer is 16.
We're talking about Cindy and her going through the business world.
Yes.
Can you imagine Cindy going into an interview as a deaf sign language professional and them trying to, like, the boss is like, all right, so give me an example. And she does it, and how often does the person interviewing know what sign language is?
Yeah,
so
right.
you're really just sitting there doing your deal, and they're like, "That looks like you're doing something,"
yeah.
But I don't know what you're
doing. I can do
doing.
That.
See, when I started doing
quality control in the 70s and 80s, it's just no one cares about sign language.
Listen,
like, yeah, put her on.
Listen, here's the deal. This is what I found out. FCC every 7 years would have the stations relicense, and in that it was mandatory that they had something they had to do for community, some just a good thing that they were doing for the community. I happened to come in at the right time and say I would like to interpret the news for the deaf, and they go, there's deaf people out there. I went, oh yeah, and they watch TV but they can't hear what's going on, so
sure.
If I could stand next to
the closed captioning,
it
always a game.
No, and that wasn't there. You know,
well, I mean, today, like, it's a game. You watch it, or like they're probably about 70% accurate. And you're
right.
Like, ugh.
And you know who told me?
Think about that, Cindy. I want to know your stories about this.
So,
alternative truth.
So anyway, so I go in there and talk to them about how many deaf people there are, and they all watch TV. Channel 13 is their favorite.
Wonderful.
So you actually had to fight for this. This wasn't something that Channel 13 was like, you know, we want to improve our community relations.
No, I found out after the fact. I had gone to New Orleans and found out how they were doing their news for the deaf, how they got that started, who the sponsor was and all that stuff. So I had that in my back pocket when I went in and said, you know, this is what I would like to do is get this started on this five-minute newscast. If we could just try it on the five-minute newscast that you have during Dialing for Dollars, that's all I'm asking. And I will interpret standing next to Elmo Barrera, whoever was doing the news, stand next to them and sign what they say. Well,
what was the story with that fake interpreter with Obama?
What?
What? No, wasn't Obama. What was that?
You know what I'm talking about? It was like a couple years ago. It was the Mandela Memorial.
People called me from all over saying, was that guy doing the right thing? And he wasn't. He wasn't.
Sign language?
Yeah, he wasn't interpreting it correctly. It got to be a big thing about what was this guy doing and how did he get that job? And what was the
interpretation? Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, what kind of quality control is there? Someone interviewing somebody who has no idea of anything about sign language.
Exactly.
And like I said, here's Cindy. Yeah. You know, I want to do this. Well, give me, like, how do we make sure she knows what she's doing?
Well, let me tell you.
We'll probably get some phone calls.
Marvin Zindler and I started the same day. And
really?
He told me, he said, you know, I know sign language. I know it because I worked for the Houston Press and I did sign language. I did sign language. I said, that's so cool. That's great. And he says, but, you know, how do we know you're doing what they say?
Yeah.
I'm going to have to watch and see. I said, well, that's great. If you know sign language. And he goes, yeah, let me show you. So he starts spelling something to me, and it looked like Russian. I had no idea. I said, what? I said, let's go over the letters again. Are you doing this for? And he was doing K for P, and he was doing like S for T. And so he'd forgotten a lot of the letters.
Would you say?
I only know one sign
but
language.
Would you say deaf people are really good spelling bee people?
Probably. I don't know. I have no idea. But that you do have to know how to spell to be able to.
Oh, he said deaf people. I thought he said dead people. I couldn't even figure out what the heck he was talking.
Anyways, so Marvin Zindler went to the news director and said, "You're having somebody out up there stand there to do the news, and she could be saying anything. Yeah. Nobody here except me knows."
Oh, so I know someone did actually ask a quality control question.
Yes.
Good. Good for Marvin Zindler.
That's what I'm saying. So they said, well, she looks like she's starting and finishing with the person. So,
you had an accreditation, right? You had paperwork that showed you that you went to a class. You didn't just make up sign language.
No, I didn't make up sign language, but I was on a TV show called Signing with Cindy. So they felt like that gave me some
credibility. You really don't have, you don't have, like, an accreditation where, say I wanted to hire you and I want to let you interpret Donald Trump.
Yes.
I'll be like, I need some accreditation.
Show me some ID.
It's a certification. You have to have a certification.
And is it good?
Was
you have to renew it?
You have to renew it. I only did it one time. They gave me, because of what I was doing, they were like, you're fine.
Would you go do it now? Would you get recertified?
Would I get a test? No, I could never pass. No, it's way too hard.
When's the last time you did any type of research on new sign language stuff?
Research on it?
Yeah.
I just look at the books they put out and see what. Because I have a book called Signing with Cindy, and I want to see what their book, that's what I was always looking at. Before, it was
You have a book called Signing with Cindy?
Yeah. And I
didn't know that.
Yeah, it went along with the
series.
We're
learning so much today.
No, it went along with the series.
Oh, she's involved in the deaf community, and that's why I was trying to understand, when people see that, no one knows anything about the deaf community. So it's just kind of like, yeah, sure.
True. Yes. Yeah.
Sure.
No,
go up there. How this guy got to do the Mandela Memorial.
I'm sure.
Yeah, sure.
Exactly, yeah.
He's from that country. He should be good. I mean,
we need somebody to sign language. I do sign language.
Because I had only been signing like maybe 9 months when I started doing the 13. But the deaf said, we want you to do it because you're the one that went and got it done. You got it on the air. I thought they'd want to use their blue blood interpreters that had, family members that were born into the
family.
I'd be
shocked when she talks about her past and all this wonderful, big-timey stuff she did. It's like dementia.
Have you treated yourself and gone online and looked at her Signing with Cindy videos?
No, I haven't.
You are in for a treat.
Oh, my goodness gracious.
I think my favorite one is Sunshine on My Shoulders. Did you film that in Galveston? Where did you film that? And
it was in Galveston. One of the producers went to Galveston with his wife, and they sat on the beach and drank wine, and they waited to see when would be the best time.
Oh, it was beautifully shot.
because the sky would reflect at a certain time during the sunset. So they had, so we had like 45 minutes to get this. It had to be shot in one
take. The song's like three and a half minutes.
Yeah, and it was like, you have to get this done. Like,
did they play it on like a cassette player, or did they actually overlay it?
They had, because I had to hear
it. How'd you hear it?
Yeah.
Well, maybe she memorized it.
No, they were playing it on the speakers and all that. And
you should see it, Dennis.
I intend to see it.
She did that, and then she did.
It's amazing.
She did one on the courthouse. Is it the courthouse or city hall? What song was that?
That's Fame.
Fame. Okay, so
yeah.
The whole presentation of this is the song's playing over Dennis, and she signs it. And so, like, Sunshine on My Shoulders, it literally looks very similar to, like, The Sound of Music when she's on the grass and she's doing it, and it's wonderful. Like, I can't believe it was something that you're part of, because
Richard, something I was part of.
She's got a lot of stuff inside her.
Because that was pretty special, Cindy. People have reached you on your YouTube, messaged you, and say, look, I got these videos.
This is a guy. Let me tell you who this guy is.
I'll put that link on mine. Yeah.
This guy is in.
People reach out to her. And
let me tell you.
They're huge fans.
These are.
Being king.
What are the guys that dress up like women and do the shows in New York?
We're just going to talk in between you remembering stuff. Transgenders.
Not trans. No.
Queens or.
No. What do they call the people that sing and they perform?
Shakespearean actors.
And they're men and they do like Cher.
Drag
queen. Drag queen. This guy is like one of the top.
It's like categories.
The top drag queen in New York City, and so he started putting these videos out because he was such a big fan. And so I saw it, and I contacted him. I said, "Hey, thank you so much for showing these videos." He got scared. He thought he was going to get in trouble because he was, putting these out. And I said, "No, go ahead, put them all
out.
Unless you have
probably part of the public domain."
And he said, "You don't know how big you are in the drag queen, society. They love you. They think you're.
I don't have a problem believing that at all.
You're just like Bette Midler and
so Mark why aren't Christian. We getting them to call in? Why are we not doing that?
I don't know his number. I just did it through Facebook, and not Facebook, but it was put on YouTube. He put it on YouTube, and so he has his own. His own channel, and this was a big part of it. And he told everybody that Cindy Cochran contacted me, and this was like, it was so funny. I didn't know I was big in that group. So
I forgot my cough button.
But anyway, I wanted to. You said something. I just got it. You said something about you kept thinking he was saying dead.
That's what I thought he said.
I had a secretary come in. I was working at Time Warner. I had a secretary come in, and I said, I want you to take a letter and send this to. John Bon Jovi. He was coming in town.
Oh.
And I was starting to do some shooting that PBS wanted of just things that people do that use sign language, how they use sign language and all that. My daughter loved John Bon Jovi. Loved him. So I thought, this is a way. So I sent this letter to him saying, you're coming into town, and I just want to know if it's okay if we could get seated on the front row so that I could interpret this song. She loves you, and I'm going to interpret the song for her or any deaf people that might want to come.
Put in the door.
And she's deaf, and she loves you. She just has always listened to your song. Anyway, every time I said the word deaf, the secretary was writing dead in there. And she never questioned me. She never said anything about it. She didn't say, like, why would you be asking him to come up, and why do you want to sign for a dead person? Anyway, this went to him. The manager, John Bon Jovi, wrote me back and said, we don't see how this, we think this is pretty creepy, and we don't see why you would want to be signed. I was so embarrassed, and I took the letter, and I went, you said dead. But a lot of people may make that mistake, but it was bad. It was embarrassing.
Did you ever get that?
No. They thought I was in crazy, a nutcase. So I went like, okay, fine. I should have started out with, I've been on the Johnny Carson show a couple of times. So I'm like familiar with this entertainment business stuff. But no, I didn't do that. Anyway, So it's a lot of fun things that happen like that. When we come back, I'm going to talk to Dennis about McDonald's. Both of us remember when McDonald's first started.
You betcha.
Yeah, so we want to talk about that and the movie Founder. It's coming out, or it's out now this weekend. I think it started this weekend. Okay, we'll be right back. You're listening to Cindy Cochran Show, Real Reality Radio. Everybody's always trying to jump in on the show. You cannot be on the show unless I say it's okay. Stop it. Just stop it.
Electronic.
You're listening to Cindy Cochran Show and my special guest, Dennis O'Connor, which...
Hello.
I've been talking too much, I guess. I'm not letting them talk. But
oh, no. You're well, not you guys, get my way.
You guys got me started. I'm like the substitute teacher that comes in, and everybody knows that if we can just get her on a subject she likes to talk about,
we're never going to get the history.
No homework, nothing. This is, we all do that. Okay, so Dennis and I are about the same age. I'm a couple of years older than he is.
Yep.
And so I was born in 48. When were you born? You're 40,
51.
51. Okay. So... Anyway, we remember the beginnings. Now, not the brothers who started it. I'm talking about when it came and got really popular, like in 55, some 56, something like that.
Yes, when it became nationwide.
Right. And in 3 years, he started the franchises that he put out. In 3 years, those franchises brought in like $7 million in 3 years.
Unbelievable.
And I remember I wish I could go back exactly. I remember looking up and it said how many hamburgers they'd sold.
Yes.
And like, it was just like under 100. I mean, it was just like 100 sold. But it went up fast because of the franchises. I thought it was one place had sold that many, you know.
They had to change those signs too.
Yeah, all the time,
It wasn't electronic back then. They had to go up and change that number, you know. Probably. These guys got tired of going, oh, my gosh. You want me to change it again? Didn't we just change it yesterday?
And
yes, but it's a million now.
You know what's sad about this movie coming out with Michael Keaton playing Ray Kroc, who was he's the guy that was stopped by the restaurant and went in and started looking at this place and how they run it and how they, the processes that they used. Yeah, Michael Keaton played.
Oh, wonderful.
He plays the one that. Discovered them. But he started telling them, look, you guys, this could be really big. You're the ones that could take this where everybody in America will have tasted your hamburgers. We are going to get a process started and we'll have a big M and under that M, standing for McDonald's, your name.
That was all Ray's idea.
Yeah, he owns now that name. Yeah. I mean, he bought it in 58. I think he bought the name of it, but he was the one who really put the business behind it and pushed it out there. But what's funny to me is that he said what really attracted me is they only had three things they sold, a hamburger, French fries, and a drink. And that was it. It was so simple. And I was like, why haven't people thought about this before? And people just flocked to it because the big thing was quality.
You could run in and run out right out.
That's right. I mean, how fast it was. Really fast food. The meat and how the quality of the meat and all that. Now, you don't think that much right now because when you bite into a hamburger, McDonald's, it seems like it's thin. It's not as heavy, like some of the places we went. I went to Chuck Wagon and they had a beefy, hamburger. Yeah. And something like you get at home.
It's
but this
all you can eat thing.
Right. It was so huge. But you remember it was just like mayonnaise and those finely chopped
tiny things.
Chopped onions. Real fine chopped onions. And it was so good. And we just kept going back and back, because we could afford, could afford it.
Yeah, I'd go over there from school.
Oh, that was so awesome. So but in Houston, people that are listening that live in Houston, you remember the Chuck Wagon. And that place, the onions they used would stay with you for days. I mean, on your clothes, in your hair, whatever. And when I started recording, there was a recording studio. And I was signed to the label that they had. It was Walt Andrews Studio. They're on Broadway. And that's where everybody went. And, you know, the catered food came from Chuck Wagon. They
Get
came
on
there.
With it.
And it was, it smelled, that place just smelled like onions. There was no way to get rid of the onion smell until people started smoking marijuana. And then the marijuana, I didn't know what people were smoking. And they would, and the bands would drink a lot of cough medicine. I thought, this is the sickest band I have ever seen. Everybody's sick every day. They drink cough medicine. And that smell of cough medicine and...
cough medicine, cigarettes,
and onions. It was just, that makes me go back in time to when I was recording. But it's just funny that McDonald's came on and just took over. I mean, they went crazy. And they're in the movies. They're just an icon that everybody knows.
And they still advertise. That's what I tell people. When I used to do PR over at Crichton Theater, you know, don't you think you've got enough out there? And I say, did you? And McDonald's still advertises.
That's right.
Never enough advertising. Never. They're the biggest place in the world. And yet they still advertise like they're trying to bring people in somehow.
Well, you know, they took Ronald away for, they had him away for a while because of the creepy clown thing.
Yeah, well, that was
a
big scandal. Yeah. That was the scandal with him and the...
Oh, that. But no, I'm talking about recently.
I just made that up.
No, recently.
I don't think there was a scandal.
Just go ahead and do fake news.
I just made that up. Yes,
no, but
absolutely.
But they took him away because of the creepy clown thing that went on. Do you know about that?
Oh, yeah.
And so people have just gone crazy.
That was weird.
So they had to take him off of that. But here's what's happened.
I love weird.
The founder starts. This new movie comes out. And just at this time, McDonald's announces.
Oh, I got it now. He's the founder of McDonald's.
Yes, of the franchise.
Okay, I'm up to speed now.
Okay, all right. So it takes a while. He's from the 60s. Okay.
Right.
No, so anyway... What's bad is that McDonald's is announcing that their sales are really down, and they're trying different ways now to bring people back in. So they started the breakfast all day, and that's hurt them.
Yeah.
Everybody was so excited, breakfast all day, yay!
Yeah.
And you can get it any time, but now, no.
Yeah, Charlie Babbitt likes breakfast. I go there all the time,
You know, you can sound so much like
How
that's
would that hurt
scary.
It?
How would what hurt it?
Yeah, well, how's that
breakfast
scary?
All the time, how's that hurt it?
They're not selling. It's not selling. So they make up all these breakfast things, and the sales aren't where they should be. And so...
Well, I mean, that means they're not selling anything at all. So why would that have to be due to breakfast?
No.
Sounds like no one's going there just to eat, because...
No,
what?
No, the breakfast thing has brought them down, because they spent a lot on that, doing all-day breakfast. And so... They were hurting because the people were not responding to
it. Do they have it ready, and are they filling dumpsters with Egg McMuffins that aren't selling, or what?
You know, I think it's because they decided after 12 or 11 or whatever, they wouldn't do the biscuit and sausage. They were doing the McMuffin. And McMuffin. But I like the biscuit.
Yeah,
biscuits are really good.
That's really a horrible decision right there.
Yes, I'm telling you, it just ruined the... No, but...
I mean, that's pretty stupid to do... Like a McGriddle over a just sausage biscuit. Like, that's their flagship.
I know it. I don't understand it. But what hurts me the most is that Chick-fil-A, I talked to one of the managers there. They said they are testing how McDonald's is going to do with an all-day breakfast.
Right.
And if they do well, we will do the same thing. We're going to follow suit. And everybody's getting pretty excited about it.
Ooh.
The next time I saw him, I said, are we going to have breakfast all day? He says, they're still studying it. So now that McDonald's is saying that that's hurt them, not helped them.
I believe that's called the International House of Pancakes. There, you can get breakfast all day. Huh?
Yeah, you can get it all day.
Just go there. Denny's, right?
IHOP.
You get breakfast.
Denny's. All day.
That's right.
And it's not hurting them.
Yeah.
But that's how they started.
McDonald's just trying to horn in on a new territory.
I'm telling you. They tried, and... didn't seem to be very successful, but
McDonald's is not known for failure.
No, they are not, and they'll shove it down our throats. No, I think that's going to happen is that you know, people. I think that the people that go to McDonald's, the younger people, would not eat breakfast all day. You know, so I think it's their crowd who's coming in and buying this is what is not good. Like Denny's, the older people go to Denny's.
Right.
Older people go to IHOP.
I wake up at 3 o'clock in the afternoon a lot.
Yes, that's exactly right. It's breakfast.
I wake up at 7 o'clock at night.
I think you are their audience.
Time. Well, of course I am.
You're the one.
Old retired farts.
I love it.
Can you say farts on the air?
I think we can. I think you just did. I'd rather you say that instead of the F word.
Fart is an F word.
Okay, that's what I'm saying. I said instead of the other F word. I don't say. Say that. Okay. I'm so proud of you.
Howard Stern,
you're
really quickly.
You're doing so well.
I'm just being a nice guy.
Mark, when we did the Mark and Cindy show, we had Dennis on, and we kept saying to him as he sat down, I remember, you can't say any of those bad words. You can't do it.
Construction.
And then we go to a break, and we say, okay, you did real good for that first 15 minutes. Now, are you going to be able to hang on? I was so worried about you. But
so I had to go outside, smoke a cigarette, and cuss.
Yeah, get it out of your system. Get it out of your system before you come back in here.
Ratsa fratsa.
Dennis.
What show was that they said ratsa fratsa instead of cussing? Ratsa fratsa. It was old TV show.
Oh.
Ratsa fratsa. Was that Soupy Sales? No, it wasn't Soupy Sales.
I know what you're talking about. Yeah. They wouldn't say the bad words. So
yeah, you could back in those days.
The Honeymooners. All the things that we remember that was really, really good. Like, they used to have really good TV shows. And
get Will in here, the guy that was in Miracle on 34th Street, plays a judge. He was a judge. He is a judge. Old, but he's all retired. But he has the most amazing knowledge of all things old. You name a darn TV show. I happen to mention Soupy Sales. And he brought a DVD of Soupy Sales to me.
Good
and
grief.
Told me where he came from and all the whole history. I mean, you know, you're one of these guys, you ask him what time it is, he'll tell you how to build a watch.
Yes,
He's just full of this trivia information about the old days. You'd love him.
That would be fun. But I think that, you know, I just...
What are we talking about?
No, we were talking about McDonald's.
McDonald's.
And we have veered off of that.
Well, that's what
course.
A train track...
Well, anyway, so the movie, are you going to go see the movie?
If it's got Michael Keaton in it, yeah, you bet. I can't say when. I mean, I don't rush to the theater like you do. I go every now and then.
I haven't been. So there's not been any really good movies out. So The Founder sounds good. And the women who helped get the first rocket. Hidden Figures.
Hidden Figures.
Yeah, so that's...
Yeah,
that's
gotta catch that one.
Yeah, that sounds really good. I love that because we grew up in that time. Like, my grandparents, my grandmother, lived on a, she was from Louisiana.
Chicken house.
And they lived on...
Factory.
No, where the...
Bedstead.
The black people were the slave. She lived
antebellum
on...
Antebellum
Plantation. She lived on...
What? She lived on a plantation, son.
She grew up, and my father was like Archie Bunker, and so it was so hard growing up, and I just argue and fight against them and say, you know, this is so wrong, and this is terrible.
Yes. Prejudice.
I remember asking my grandmother one time, well, don't you believe that this lady who was her maid is she's a real person, right? And she went... Well, but her trying to answer that shocked me.
My dad was prejudiced as heck. I mean, N-word flowed freely, didn't bother him a bit. Didn't think a thing of it. Nobody else did either around us, you know?
Well, I mean.
Everybody talked like that, you know.
That's how sometimes when people judge someone that when they were 10 years old, they said this, or when they were 15 and. And if you look and see how they grew up and at what time they grew up, that's all you knew. But
our generation changed the world.
That's right, because didn't you feel like there's something wrong with this?
You're welcome. You're welcome.
I never did go march though. I never did. I never did the marching thing.
He did stuff like that
to
protest. Signing. That's going some. That's but creative. That's helping people.
That's right.
Uplifting. It's
making
generosity.
Aware.
It's love.
I just wanted
love
people
and peace, baby.
I wanted people to know that there were deaf people out there, and that this to raise the awareness that they are,
wonderful.
And that they're just like. So when we did,
handicaps.
Right. So, but it was people. I never protested for somebody to like in a protest. I went to the fire department, the police department, and said, you have deaf people who live here. Did you watch this on TV every night
right after the Vietnam War?
What?
Shots of the Vietnam War, of us marching down the streets and end the war?
Of course.
Okay, well, you saw the protest.
I saw the protest, but I never was, like, in one.
Yeah, well.
But, see, I did it this way. I would go to the police station and say, police department, and say, you have got deaf people that live here. This is how many. One out of every ten probably have a hearing impairment that you don't know, because they're very silent. They're very silent about it. But those people have emergencies.
They're very silent about it?
Yeah.
Was that a pun?
Yeah. No, but I said these people have emergencies, and they have to run and find someone to call for them.
Oh, my goodness gracious,
And so it takes so much longer for them to get someone in. Woo-hoo. And I said, but if you would put a TTY, this is how they communicate with each other. They type messages back and forth. This was like way before texting.
Yeah.
And so they type messages back and forth, and this is how they converse with each other. But if we had one of these in the police department, they could they could type this message to you, and then you would be able to answer their call. So that's all I'm asking is if you bet. Okay. The fire department finds out that I went to the police department, and they said they would study it, kind of thing. The fire department comes to a meeting I had with a deaf community. The head of the fire department comes in, and he's sitting in the back, and after it's over, he came and said, listen, police department's never going to get that done. We'll do it. We'll do it, and then let them follow suit. I would rather us do it first, if that's okay with you. And I don't care who does it first. But I didn't know they were competitive. I didn't realize the police department and the fire department were kind of, you know, friendly competitor.
Yeah.
So the fire department announces they're going to do this. The police department calls, why are they doing? I said, well, because you were studying it, and I thought, as long as you study it.
You snooze, you lose, baby.
Yeah, I said, because they can call them with the emergency. So they said, well, we're going to do this, so we want you to let everybody know that
we're doing this. So that must have made you feel great.
It was amazing.
Now, that's amazing. But
it didn't take a protest, though.
Well, you know, like, how am I going to end the Vietnam War, you know?
Right.
I can't just go into the White House and say, hey, you know, look, it'd probably be a good idea if you maybe not do that, you know, not send all my brothers and sisters, you know, into a meat grinder for no reason.
Right.
You know, that wouldn't have worked too well. You know, I wouldn't have had anything to suggest.
I think there's probably a place. Yeah, there's probably a place.
I think the 6 o'clock news did more help than anything.
Yeah, right. Well, we had television.
Showing the war. Afghanistan, if they show the Middle East right now, if they did that same thing, things would be a lot different. Attitudes would be a lot different.
But you know,
we got to see all these
kids being killed
over there.
Aleppo, the little boy from Aleppo that they came and they set him down in the ambulance, and he's got blood like all over his face, and he's trying to get his hair out, and he's just sitting there looking around like so scared,
he's about five years old.
And that resonated with a lot of people. That really upset people that this is what it is.
Yeah,
and
they
it's
don't
like.
Do that much.
Yeah.
That's what's really weird about the media, that they don't show that anymore. People, you know, I don't know what movie I was watching that was, they said, we don't want to see that anymore.
Right.
We don't want to see that anymore.
That's so sad.
Could you please do your war? you know.
We'd rather talk about for days and days on end that Donald Trump tweeted something and it made everybody mad. And so they'll talk about that forever concentrating on some stuff that we need to listen to and talk about. And we do have a break. Okay.
Can I tell you my favorite thing that I don't know if it's
true
or not?
Are you interrupting us? What's going on here?
Yeah.
Oh, gee, wow.
You know that photo they're sharing on the social media about all the how many people went to the inauguration?
Oh, yes. Oh,
well, apparently somebody found that photo and searched, like, went through it, and there's a clock in the photo. And apparently it's taken an hour and a half after the inauguration.
Oh, because Dennis... They were comparing...
Oh, I know.
They were trying to say
that
Obama's...
I've seen it a million times.
Yeah.
Online.
Oh, there's a clock.
But,
they found.
Know, there was...
That's hilarious.
You got to be dumb to know that. I mean, you don't have to be dumb to know that there were more people on the thing in Washington than there were at Trump's inauguration. It's just a fact. I don't care. I know the picture was taken an hour after, but I guarantee
you think Obama had
more people.
You think Obama had more people than Trump?
Oh, I don't know. Yeah, Obama had
the main statement they said.
Oh, you're talking about the women thing.
The women had. And I don't see anything wrong with that.
No, it's fine.
I feel bad about that. Martin Luther King. You know, this has been wonderful protests and marches, and that's wonderful. That's the United States of America. That's why those guys are in Afghanistan. They tell us.
We're dying so
somebody can do that, you know.
Right. No,
because they can't do that here.
But I think you're talking about, I'm going to clarify this, you're talking about the pictures they took at the inauguration. They took pictures of the mall.
And
then they compared it to a picture they had of Obama's inauguration and saying that there were more people at his inauguration than Trump.
Yeah, they compared
Trump
it to
said
Obama and
that was fake. That was not right. Are you saying so the ones that showed that there was hardly anybody left on the mall was taken after the inauguration had happened? I was just saying the picture
that people have been using was taken an hour and a half after, after.
Of Trump's
inauguration, yeah.
Okay, so, and they were trying to say that's how many people were there during the inauguration.
It's called media spin. I don't believe anybody.
Well, you know what's funny? The greatest thing to come away from all this is people started starting to pay attention to how our government works.
Amen, brother.
So, like, as people are talking about him freezing the EPA and freezing all these divisions, but that's normal.
Mm-hmm.
Obama did that.
Yeah. But, a lot of things
so
that
the other president before him did it. The other president before him did it. It's normal term of business. Running a business, you got to freeze the assets and look at what they're spending money on when you're trying to evaluate things like that. But
you should
watch the press releases or the press secretary doing his stuff.
I've watched everyone.
Yuck.
Well, many people are watching
Spicer,
it now.
Yeah. Because the press and the... The feud with the president has been pretty funny. He comes out and starts,
it's the dog and pony show.
The very first press conference he had, he lectured all of them about they better tell the truth. We're getting sick of listening to your lies and all that stuff.
You couldn't write a weirder script for reality than what these guys are actually doing.
What's happening?
Because I told people a long time ago that I was going to change my vote to Trump. Because I want to see how weird it can really get.
You're right. And you know what?
And boy, did I get heck from all my liberal friends. Because 99% of my friends were for Clinton and a few were for Trump. You know, they went crazy when I said that. I said, let's just find out how. I didn't use those exact words.
Yes.
Let's just find out how screwed up it can get.
Now listen, people that watch this on YouTube can read lips, so you got to be careful. You just got to see. That's why you want to subscribe to my YouTube channel, is because you want to make sure that you're going to have to go wash your hands right now. Stop it! And he's trying to sign to me, and
that's why the camera's not on right now.
I'm signing to the audience.
No, I just told Dennis. I just told Dennis that.
Camera on
one
me now,
day,
Nick?
One day a week.
Is the camera on me now?
No, it's on me.
No, it's not on me.
It's not on you.
No.
Okay. Okay, I know that sign too. You gotta expand your vocabulary.
Okay,
bring
the camera back to me. I'll be the captain of this ship.
Yeah, captain.
I was invited in at the last
Dennis
minute to run
here.
This ship.
Yeah.
Ahoy, matey, what we got over there?
You know what's so mean this morning is Dennis called me this morning and goes, Cindy, I don't think I can make it. And I just said, I don't care. You're going to make it. I'm so sick of people calling me and saying they're sick. You're going to be there. And he goes, I'm just kidding.
She didn't invite for a second on that.
I knew he was lying. Because he listens to the Cindy Cochran Show, and he knows what I'd
more than
complained.
I ought to. Yeah, way more than I ought to.
Has it changed your life, Dennis?
Yes, it has, actually.
Oh.
Yes.
And your perspective on...
I stay home. From 10 to 11, I stay home almost all the time now. I never go out. I don't go out.
See, But you can, you can go out and get in your car and go to 106.1 and listen to the show.
Actually,
on
what
your radio.
I do, I listen to it on my clock radio. I've got you on a 46-inch TV screen for your web page.
Yeah.
But then I've got my clock radio in the room, and I turn it on because that makes the sound at the right time. There's no delay.
Ah.
There's no delay.
There
so
you go.
So if I'm typing comments, I want to be typing comments, you know.
He's the most prolific comment writer.
I'm a producer. Thank
yes,
you
that's
much.
It. Thank you very much.
I tell her exactly when she's really
well,
gearing
on. Yeah. What I love
get back on track.
Is somebody's been messaging her, and I put the laptop up for her to look at, and I left it on the message screen for her.
Yeah, the message to her right now?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Come
it's
on.
It's Carly.
Carly! Hi, Carly! Hi,
Carly
so,
said, hi, Dad.
I've been waiting for her to... I
How
mean,
long
I don't know what else
made
to do.
Carly wait? How long have you made Carly wait?
Let me look, go back. Let's see
oh,
how many
no,
of this
no,
she
no,
said.
No, 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 we don't have that much time.
Cindy, where are you? I just wanted to say hi.
I'm just trying to...
Dennis.
Carly's
say
trying to
hello.
Get some nice photos
hey,
of
Cindy,
herself.
Hey, Cindy.
Yes.
It's time to wrap up the show.
Oh, oh no.
Well, wait a minute.
What
I got to say hi to Carly. Carly is trying to get some nice photos of herself. Carly, you just got to get the backlight behind you and not shoot them up your nose. Remember that. Reach out with the thing.
Thank you, Dennis.
Up your nose.
Tomorrow, Donna Wick. You can't miss this with Donna Wick. We're going to let her expound. She's going to tell us how she became a famous entrepreneur and rich
a
and
woman.
All that.
A
rich
woman. Woman.
A rich
strong,
woman.
Powerful, rich
strong.
Woman.
You're listening to the Cindy Cochran Show. Real Reality Radio. We'll see you tomorrow. Don't miss it.